Good morning. I feel I need to apologize this morning. I believe after last week's preacher, my dress sense is maybe a little sedate compared to last week's preacher. It was a topic of the conversation at your space on Thursday night, just how well dressed last week's preacher was, matching shoes, tie, handkerchief in their pocket. But there you go, I'm a little bit more sedate than Alan, but thank you, Alan, for taking last week's service. And just on that note of your space, we were out on Thursday night at the Welcome Chinese on Strammillis, and if you've never been there, I can highly recommend their deep fried ice cream. Absolutely beautiful. It's probably one of the reasons why I can't fit into the nice suits that Alan wears. But you're all welcome here this morning. We've a number of announcements. Next week's service is a special service for the Queen's Platinum Jubilee, and Wednesday night's committee meeting has had to be postponed, so I'd send out a little notification. Also then, General Synod for the non-subscribing Presbyterian Church of Ireland takes place in a week's time, or 2 weeks' time. The Remonstrant Synod of Ulster meeting takes place in First Dunmurry Presbyterian non-subscribing Presbyterian Church at 3:30 p.m. on the 14th, followed by the Trustee Company at 4:15, and then the Synod Communion Service will be here at 7:30 p.m., followed by the Synod Service and installation of moderator at 8:15. And then Wednesday the 15th of June is our business meeting here in All Souls at 10:30 a.m. And I have discharged my duties under the Code of Discipline for giving out those details this morning. Also, the ladies in the non-subscribing Presbyterian Church, as you know, this year there's been a focus on the women within the non-subscribing Presbyterian Church, are holding a walk and a dinner on Saturday the 20th of August at Montanto Estate and then Rockmount Golf Club afterwards. So if anyone would like to go to that, let me know and they can put their names down. We also have our trip to Dublin to hear of the Dissenters of Protestantism in Dublin by Rory Delaney on Saturday the 11th of June. And there is some space still available if anyone would like to go see me at the end. And I'll test you on all those announcements at the end. If you're visiting, you're very welcome this morning. And also there's little cards in the pews if you would like to get to know us better or would like some more details, please complete those and put them in the box at the back. We come this morning together as a group to in fellowship with each other. And as we come together, I want to open with these sentences from Luke 6, verses 37 to 42. Do not judge others, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn others, or it will all come back against you. Forgive others, and you will be forgiven. Give and you will receive. Your gift will return to you in full, pressed down, shaken together to make room for more, running over and poured into your lap. The amount you give will determine the amount you receive back. Then Jesus gave the following illustration. Can one blind person lead another? Don't they both fall into a ditch? Students are not greater than their teacher, but the student who is fully trained will become like a teacher. And why worry about the speck in your friend's eye when you have a log in your own? How can you think of saying, friend, let me help you get rid of that speck in your eye when you can't see past the log in your own eye? That's hypocritical. First, get rid of the log in your own eye, then you will see well enough to deal with the speck in your friend's eye. And so let us join together in our first hymn, hymn number 428, if you're using the Red Book, New Every Morning Is the Love.
Everybody, another gorgeous day. So just wanted to read some encouraging scripture today, which is Matthew chapter 7 verses 7. Ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks the door will be opened. Hope that's encouraged. Thank you, folks.
Thanks, Sam. Let us turn to God in prayer. Let us pray. Eternal and ever-loving God, we come before you now to seek our petitions in prayer. We come before you now with the concerns that weigh us down, with the concerns for others. We take some time to pause in our busy lives, to take time to reflect, to gather together as a community, to offer love and support to each other. We do so in the hope of the strength that comes from you, a strength that helps us through the difficult times in life. And sometimes we forget to say thank you when things have gone well for us. Sometimes we only come to you in prayer at times when we need that assistance. And so this morning, as we gather with thankful hearts, hopefully with a love in our hearts, a smile on our face, a kind word for those whom we come into contact with, forgiveness for those who have done us wrong. On a day like today, where the sun is shining, the birds are tweeting, and yet we know there's so much unhappiness, both here and around the world. For those who don't have enough money to make ends meet, for those who are struggling at the loss of a job, for those who are going through ill health, for those who have lost a loved one. And we particularly think this morning of the Kirk family, of Alan and the loss of his grandmother, of Malcolm and Anne and the whole family circle and the grieving that they are going through. We ask them just to be with them as they prepare for the arrangements. Be with them in the days to come. And when things are sad and lonely, may their memories of happy times together give them the strength to see things through. And we think of all those who mourn, all those who are lonely, all those who are coming to a stage in life where they find it harder to do things they once were able to do, who want to be that young person out running, out doing what they used to do, but age sadly slows them down. And so we think of all those known and unknown to us who are in need of your support. And in a time of silence, we bring all those prayers which weigh heavy on our hearts to you now. Eternal and loving God, as we heard read this morning, knock and the door will be opened unto you. We ask these in all our prayers in the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And so let us join together in our second hymn, hymn 39. Praise ye the Lord, 'tis good to raise.
Thank you.
Our second reading today, I've taken some words from the book of Proverbs, and it's Proverbs 11. The Lord detests the use of dishonest scales, but he delights in accurate weights. Pride leads to disgrace, but with humility comes wisdom. Honesty guides good people. Dishonesty destroys treacherous people. Riches won't help on the day of judgment, but a right living can save you from death. The godly are directed by honesty, and the wicked fall beneath their load of sin. The godliness of good people rescues them. The ambitions of treacherous people traps them. When the wicked die, their hopes die with them, for they rely on their own feeble strength. The godly are rescued from trouble, and it falls on the wicked instead. With their words, the godless destroy their friends, but knowledge will rescue righteous. The whole city celebrates when the godly succeed. They shout for joy when the wicked die. Upright citizens are good for a city and make it prosper. But the talk of the wicked tears it apart. It is foolish to belittle one's neighbor. A sensible person keeps quiet. A gossip goes round telling secrets, but those who are trustworthy can keep a confidence. Without wise leadership, a nation falls. There's safety in having many advisors. There's danger in putting up for security for a stranger's debt. It's safer not to guarantee another person's debt. A gracious woman gains respect, but ruthless men only gain wealth. Your kindness will reward you, but your cruelty will destroy you. Evil people get rich for a moment, but the reward of the godly will last. Godly people find life, evil people find death. The Lord detests people with crooked hearts, but he delights in those with integrity. Evil people will surely be punished, but the children of God will go free. Amen. And we give thanks for those words from Proverbs and ask for God's interpretation into our hearts and into our minds. And now the choir.
Just a word about what we're going to be singing. It's We'll Gather Lilacs in the Spring Again. It's by Ivor Novello. I'm thinking of the Queen coming up to her Jubilee. She must be missing Philip dreadfully, like all those of us who've lost someone we once loved. There's a tradition in Eastern Europe and Central Europe, as far as Russia. When the snows have thawed and melted away, the beautiful lilacs come out in their season, and young lads of the village, country fellows, would go round with a gypsy band and bunches of lilacs and serenade the young ladies under their windows. We have a similar tradition in Ireland, so it's said, that the Irishman does his courting when the gorse is blooming, or whin. But I don't think he sticks to that. I think he's at it all year round, actually.
Thank you.
Thank you, Francis, and your groupies or support act or whatever way we call the choir. I didn't know about the wind bushes. Now that's something interesting. What I would like to say is out in Ackley we have wind bushes all year round, so maybe they are keeping with the tradition. I don't think it's any secret to anyone who has been a regular attender at All Souls or got to know me that I'm a big Disney fan. And I haven't had my fix of Disney in a couple of years because of COVID. But I've quoted before from a book I have, which is The Gospel in Disney by the Reverend Philip Longfellow Anderson. And it makes very interesting reading on how many of the Disney stories correspond to stories in the Bible. I was recently rereading the chapter on judging others, hence my choice of reading this morning. And one example that came out in that book was Lady and the Tramp. And how many of you remember that story from your childhood days, how poor old Tramp was misjudged by others until the day he came to the aid of Lady and the little baby. As I read Luke 6, verses 37 to 42, we're cautioned that there's always so much we don't know about the other person whom we're judging. Indeed, there's so much we don't know about many people. That's what's lovely about the Your Space group. We're getting to know each other, spending time chatting, enjoying good crack, as they say in Northern Ireland. It's a good opportunity to get to know those who are coming here to All Souls. Sometimes people are determined to set a speed record about leaping to conclusions about other people's lives, other people's circumstances, often because of how they look and how they act, how they are seen, what their views may be, if you even get as far as having a conversation with them. Quite often people are judged on their looks or their acts. We don't know why people act in a certain way they do. What we do know is that we're all individually made in God's creation. So the way we act is the way God made us. The way we look is the way that God made us. And if it hasn't resulted in a negative outcome for you, then why should you be concerned at judging them? I think I've used in the past that old familiar Indian prayer. Great Father, never let me judge another until I have walked in their moccasins. Isn't that a way we can all live? And would we consider what would happen if our lives changed? If we changed places for a week or two with someone whom we maybe manage in work, someone we employ, someone who maybe employs us, or indeed someone who is unemployed. What about the person who delivers our post, or in these days our Amazon deliveries all around the countryside? The person who empties our bins? The person who teaches our children? The person who waits on our table or collects our money at a car park, if there still are car park attendants out there and we've not gone to a machine? What about those who are in a nursing home? What about the person who's lost their husband, their wife, their grandparent, their child, their house, their savings? I guarantee our judgments would be very different if we had to live in that person's lives. And it may be people that we wouldn't normally associate with. If you can cast your mind back to 2 weeks ago and that sermon about the Good Samaritan and who our neighbor is. A word of caution on our own judgment. We cannot judge anyone solely and exclusively on something off the basis of their past. Surely it should be rather like a drama and wait and see how things turn out in the end. How quick we are to judge others on their past. Something we seem to get hung up on. We don't give people the opportunity to show that they can change. I'm sure we all in our lives have made mistakes, done things we regret, but sadly, once it's done, it's done. We can't wipe that clean. And at times, things that happen for quick gratification can have long-term effects in people's lives. But who are we to judge? It seems to be a natural instinct for people to look at those who we believe have carried out wrong. And we're back to how we believe. Sometimes there's a lesson there in forgiveness. But forgiveness is another sermon, or maybe a couple of sermons. As C.S. Lewis says, it's a lovely term until you have to practice it yourself. Whenever we're tempted to judge another person, we need to remember those wondrous gifts of mystery, of God's purpose, that sometimes good can come out of evil, that strength can sometimes come out of weakness, and the victory can sometimes come out of defeat. Those seeds of transformation may be planted through that grace we receive. Certainly those words remind me of that hymn, "To God Be the Glory," which the Lynchy congregation sung last week. We must always remember that the final judgment belongs to God, not to us. Sometimes we're asked to view things through the eyes of a child. So if you cast your mind back to Lady and the Tramp, we can all learn something from the morals in that story. Tramp was seen as a no-gooder. Poor Lady heard all about it while in the dog pound, and even she rejected him. Until that night that the rat got into the baby's bedroom, one would assume to do harm to the child. But Tramp saved the day. Well, eventually the truth came out, what had happened, as it always does. And that's a lesson for us all. He earned a place in the household. Remember the quote about a leopard changing its spots. We are told in Scripture that through God all things are possible. And in that pound, others suggested Trump was unsuitable for a lady of her type. Whether the lilacs or the wind bushes were out, it didn't matter. But that let others cloud her view. And shouldn't we always look at someone through our own eyes, through the eyes of a child? That's what us non-subscribers are told to do, to make up our own mind, not to follow the pack, to think for ourselves. And I apologize if I've told this story before, but as Reverend Chris would say, a good story's worth repeating. Or as the Reverend John Hearn told me once, a good sermon's always worth repeating as well. A minister just finished his first sermon in a church. He was standing at the door greeting the parishioners when one man stepped up and said, That was a terribly dull sermon, Reverend. Somewhat taken aback, the poor minister was haunted that whole week. The following Sunday, at the end of the service, the man came by and announced, "Your sermon this morning was the shallowest I'd ever heard." By the third Sunday, the minister had developed a badly shaken case of self-esteem. He was understandably nervous when the man approached him. And the minister said, "Were you in any way helped by today's sermon? The worst yet, you didn't say a thing." The poor minister, practically crushed, pointed the man out to one of the elders and asked about him. "Oh, don't pay attention to him. He's just a poor old soul who repeats what everyone else is saying." We shouldn't let others guide us. We should always think for ourselves. We should always form our own opinion of someone, especially someone whom we've never met. Get to know them. Get to understand what makes them tick, the challenges which they faced, and then make up your own mind. That's what free thinking is about. As I said, sometimes people take that risk for one moment of gratification, but it can ruin their lives forever, because you can be sure others will cast it up. But think of that, "Judge not, lest we be judged." There are many out there who tried to judge only to find themselves being judged. And in thinking about those judging others, those passages from Proverbs came to mind. The book of Proverbs gives us cause and effect, the righteous versus the wrong. And we need to put ourselves in those questions of Proverbs as we read them. In Proverbs 11, we have some words of wisdom. It is foolish to belittle one's neighbor. A sensible person keeps quiet. A gossip goes around telling secrets, but those who are trustworthy can keep a confidence. Your kindness will reward you, but your cruelty will destroy you. And those are only three of the sayings I believe in that passage that judges others. Belittling your neighbor, maybe judging them before you get to know them, remembering that parable of the Good Samaritan that I spoke on previously, and who our neighbor is. Gossips usually have pleasure in telling about other people, even if they don't know them or know the facts. Judging them. As one person said to me, "I'm not a gossip, I just like to know what's going on." But in using those words, sometimes, as I said in the parable of the Good Samaritan, it's like Chinese whispers. The gossip you're spreading may not always be factual. It may not always be true. And you don't know what the person has gone through to lead them to the action that you may be spreading. If we are kind and accept others and not judge them, we will be rewarded. Do we accept people for who they are? Do we really look at them? Do we take people for who they are, or do we try and recreate them in our image? I'm sure there are many here who have been affected by churches who have tried to mold them into their way of thinking, into what they should believe as being the truth, reproducing divisions, often failing to address their deepest spiritual and social needs. or deal with the root and cause of their problem? Do we try and harness them, or do we cast them aside because they're not really our kind of people? The parable of the prodigal son teaches us a lot from what we can learn from that. But if we harness individual talents, individual gifts, what a wonderful diversity we can have. And that's something within the non-subscribing church that I believe is crucial for our future development. It's that idea of being able to agree, to disagree, to have respect for each other's views, but to understand where someone else is coming from, and for them hopefully to understand where you're coming from. But if we can harness all those diverse thoughts and gifts, wouldn't that make a wonderful church? A church to welcome people, a church to truly be open, a church for someone to come and worship irrespective of their background, of what they've done, and how they end their earthly journey. If we think back to that parable just briefly of the prodigal son, Jesus was telling a story through that people would know, a bit like that story or the parable that I told when thinking about who our neighbor was, that farmer, that son, was able to come home after all he'd done and yet was received into the father's family again. All the past had been cast aside. It was a new story, a new chapter. And how many people come through our doors here wanting to start a new chapter in life, to leave behind what's happened in the past. Desmond Tutu's life, work, and philosophy was to identify reconciliation as a central element of the Christian identity. First becoming reconciled ourselves to God, and then helping others to do so, to be reconciled with each other. Isn't that thinking about the Lord's Prayer and forgiveness again? But until we reconcile ourselves, and sometimes that can be through issues of the past, hurt of the past, how can we help others? How can we develop as a community? How can we show God's love to each other and those coming through our doors? Susan Eastman, in her book, The Foolish Father and the Economics of Grace, says both by ancient and modern standards, the exemplary father in the parable of the prodigal son is a foolish parent. But the parable's not about being a good or bad parent. It's about an amazing God who can help us through all our difficult times. As I said, that hymn, "To God be the glory, and even the vilest offender who truly believes." The key to unlocking that story of the prodigal son, and one certainly I hadn't thought of, is the significance that that invitation remains open to all kinds of sons and daughters who hear or read and are willing to accept and rejoice with others. So before you judge someone, think of what they might have been through. Show compassion and love. Yours is not to judge, but to help. As I read the words, if I can help somebody, we never know how we're able to help someone along their journey, as they come through our doors, or as we meet them as we're out and about doing our daily business. If you do help others, there's certainly a rich reward from being able to help those.
Amen.
Let us join together in our closing hymn, hymn 60, Fill Thou My Life, O Lord My God. And may the peace which passeth understanding, the peace of God, which the world can neither give nor take away, be among us and abide in our hearts. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, rest and abide in us and those whom we love, this day and forevermore. Amen.